YouTube, this is BitFox here with another BitBlog. I wanted to apologize for taking so long to get another video out there. Life has been crazy, especially with this whole virus outbreak in the past couple of holidays. Universal's been keeping me busy, but I'm glad to get out there with another video. This one, I'm actually going to be finally revealing my top 25 albums of 2019. I know it's 2020 now and it's March, and most of you probably already have your opinions and you're now judging the new music that's come out. Let's get into the countdown of last year. So number 25, Kanye West, Jesus is King. Now, it was a very bold move for Kanye to actually go and do a gospel album, because, you know, it's not the type of person that Kanye is. He's decided to basically pull something completely different that he's never actually done before, and it's an interesting move. I wouldn't say there's not any good songs on it. There's a couple good songs, but other than that, Kanye's definitely fallen down the quality after his Life of Pablo album, so I feel like his albums are just dragging down. This new one, he can do his thing. All I know is that I don't really care about him as a person. I think he's kind of a egotistical, you know, self-centered douchebag, but his music was great, now it's really dying down in quality. Number 24 is Ed Sheeran's number 6 collaborations project. So the reason why this is number 24 is because I feel like it doesn't meet up to the expectations of his previous albums. There are some good songs on it. There's Beautiful People, which is him and Khalid. There's a lot of like big artists that you wouldn't expect on that album, you know, like Cardi B and Camila Cabello and Chris Stapleton and Bruno Mars. However, the rest of the album is, it felt very, you know, rushed, not very finished. It felt like he was trying too hard to be like hardcore pop on the album, and it just didn't feel like his typical style. Number 23 is Bastille's Doom Days. Now, I didn't get to listen to this album fully through. It sounds like their same exact sound. A lot of the songs have very depressing like vibes to it, granted the title, you know, Doom Days, but it felt like another Bad Blood essentially. It didn't feel like it was a huge step up for them musically, but you can't do the same thing on every album, otherwise you turn into AC/DC, which it works for AC/DC because every song, you know, sounds the same, but at least, you know, that's what works for them. This doesn't really work for them, as far as I know. Number 22 is Billie Eilish's When We All Fall Asleep, Where Do We Go? Now, I know this one actually won a ton of awards over at the Grammys. However, there's only really one song I like off the album, which is Bad Guy, ironically. I do really like her singles, Everything I Wanted and No Time to Die for the new James Bond film. However, this album, I feel like it's just too slow. There's some songs that are more upbeat, but really the only one that stood out to me was Bad Guy. All the rest are kind of hit or miss, and for me it was a big miss, but hey, other people like it, that's fine. Number 21 is Lana Del Rey's Norman Rockwell. Now, that album, NFR, as some people are calling it because they don't want to say but definitely one of her best. However, there's really one song that stood out to me, Doing Time, which was a cover of Sublime's song, Doing Time. And the rest of the album just felt way too slow. Granted, it's also Lana Del Rey. That's what she's known for, is doing a lot of slower paced songs. And she's a fantastic singer. She's very talented, but I feel like her songs could really like pick up the pace a little bit. Number 20 is going to be Calm Truise's Persuasion System. This album is what he calls a mini LP. There are some good songs on it. It's a good album overall, however, it doesn't feel like much of a creative, you know, expansion of Calm Truise's music. It felt more like he was just playing it safe. And I thought the same thing of his last album, Iteration. It felt like he was playing it safe with a couple of bangers, and the rest are kind of like just fillers. This album felt like mostly fillers with like one or two good songs. Number 19 is M83's Digital Shades Volume 2. Now, this one I was very surprised that M83 or Anthony Gonzalez actually decided to go through with making, you know, the second version of this album, which is an instrumental album. It's a good one overall. It's cool that he's doing more, you know, instrumental work and he's doing something different. I really liked his last album, Junk, which was, you know, very, like, 70s, 80s vibes mixed with, like, you know, alternative of today. And it was just very out there compared to, you know, his big album, which is Hurry Up, We're Dreaming. But this one is cool that he's doing something different. He's actually using sound effects and he's using different instrumentals and such from old, you know, video games. Video games from, like, say, the Super Nintendo or from Atari and stuff like that. And he's also mixing it with his synths and other instruments to make something a completely different, you know, vibe for an album than he's used to. So it's a cool album. It's, again, slow moving, but that's also what Digital Shades is. It's a very slow moving type of album, or type of, you know, series of albums, I guess, because there's two of them now, volumes. But other than that, it's a good album. It just feels like more of a soundtrack or a score than it does an actual MD3 album. Number 18 is Beck's Hyperspace. Now, this one actually disappointed me that it landed at number 18, because Beck's last album, Colors, was honestly one of my all-time favorite albums, if it's not my favorite album. Reason why is because every song's, like, really good, every song's energetic, except the last one, which is called Fix Me. You know, it puts you in a feel-good mood. This one, however, Hyperspace, the cover is super dope. And just looking at the cover, you're like, oh, this is probably going to be a really good album, or it's going to be very, you know, synth-heavy and stuff like that. I mean, it's got some, but it's not synth-heavy, I would say. But a lot of the songs are actually really, have really depressing tones to them. A lot of them deal with, like, certain topics and stuff that are very depressing. Well, some of the songs have a happy tone, but the lyrics don't. It's kind of like a Pumped Up Kicks where, you know, the song's a very feel-good summer song, then you listen to the lyrics and you're like, wait a second, this is about a school shooting. Number 17 is The Black Keys' Let's Rock. Now, the reason why I say Let's Rock is because that's how the title's, you know, said. It has quotations around Let's Rock. So, it's a good album. The guys did a really good job on this one. It's definitely very rock heavy. It reminds me a lot of their album El Camino. It's definitely back to their old style compared to their previous album before this one, Turn Blue, which came out quite a bit ago before they released this one. And this one's just, it's very predictable. It felt, you know, as if they could have created this, you know, back in their heyday. It felt like if it was made maybe like back when El Camino was made, it would have been super popular. But nowadays, it just feels like we're past that phase of music. Like, I really like Turn Blue because it was something different. But for this album, it felt too much like their old material. Number 16 is Mark Kronson's Late Night Feelings. Now, this album is definitely really good. It's way better than I was expecting it was going to be. It's a jam. It's fun. It's, you know, I don't know if it's fun per se. It's fun in a way that a lot of the music's like danceable and such. But the album, not gonna lie, is actually about heartbreak. Breakup songs and broken hearts, hearted songs and things of that nature. Like, you've got Nothing Breaks Like a Heart with Miley Cyrus. You have Find You Again with Camila Cabello. You have Late Night Feelings, which is the title track with, like, it's Like a Lie is how you pronounce her name. I feel like it's definitely a step up from his last album, Uptown Special. But this one it's definitely got a different, like, persona about it, but it's really good. Number 15 is Weezer's The Black Album. Now, a lot of people actually didn't like this song. They were like, what happened to old Weezer? But then again, people have been saying that since the Green Album. They've been saying that since Pinkerton. And I'm one of those that, if you've seen the Todd sketch with Matt Damon, I'm one of those that's Weezer ride or die. I like Weezer's newer stuff as well as their older stuff. But I can see why a lot of people don't like it. For me, this album has a lot of, you know, jams. It has a lot of songs that you can just throw on, dance around your house, or you know, jam out in your car. It's got a very different tone for what the cover portrays. Like, it's one of those where it's like, I guess you can't judge an album by its cover. Like, you see Black Album, you think, ooh, it's gonna be, you know, like their old stuff, where it's just rock heavy, but it's all mostly, like, pop rock. Which is definitely not a bad thing. There's some good songs. Like, there's Can't Knock the Hustle, there's Living in LA. It's a very pop-heavy album, which I can also understand why a lot of people aren't crazy about it, just because Weezer's done a lot of pop lately, and they haven't done a lot of rock-style music or alternative rock like they used to back in the heydays. But for me, it's a good listen. I actually really enjoy it. I like that they're trying something different. I like that it's, you know, and like Todd says, they're doing cool things right now. Number 14 is Backstreet Boys' DNA, which is kind of their comeback album, but not really, because they've still been making music even before this album came out. This is just their first album to come out that actually has, you know, hits on it. Like, it's got Don't Go Breaking My Heart, Chances, No Place. Like, I felt like their last good album that they made was, like, Black and Blue, which came out way at the beginning of, you know, the 2000s or like late 90s or so. This album is really good. It definitely shows their vocal range and that they're, you know, still committed to being a group and being together and touring together. And it's definitely got some bangers on it. There's some really good songs. It's really composed well. It's very pop heavy with some R&B influences, which is really nice. But yeah, it's really good. Number 13 is Tycho's Weather, which for a lot of people is the same way, kind of similar to the Weezer album and such. It's one of those that a lot of people were hit or miss about. Some people either loved Saint Sinner as a singer on the album, or they completely hated it. But they got nominated for a Grammy for that album, aside from their previous album before it, Epoch, which also was nominated in the same category for Best Dance Electronica Album, which is pretty cool to be nominated twice, one album after the other. Granted, they didn't win, which is unfortunate, but man, what an honor would it be to be nominated twice for a Grammy, especially for an indie band like them. So this album, I actually enjoyed a lot of the vocals. It's definitely a different path from their usual stuff. It feels more mature, and they actually released a companion album this year, which is called Simulcast, which is basically all of that album just reworked and vocals removed, and it's basically a full instrumental album, typical to what they're used to doing. But I think it's a nice thing that they're doing, trying something different with vocals. They're trying something different with a, you know, singer. They're trying something different where, you know, it's more of an updated electronic vibe. It's not like, you know, clubby. It's not anything like that. It's still their, you know, minimalist, chill type of music, but it's definitely something that's different from what they usually do. Number 12 is Taylor Swift's Lover. This one is interesting. At first, when the song Me with Brendan Urie of Panic at the Disco came out, I was not very, you know, for it. It didn't feel like, you know, albums such as 1989 or Reputation. It felt very different. It wasn't like, you know, didn't feel like her at first. It felt like she just basically made Shake It Off 2.0. But then when You Need to Calm Down came out and it was like all about LGBT rights and everything, I was like, oh my God, thank you. Like, the fact that she's coming out there now and she's being, you know, public about gay rights, trans rights, about voting, you know, just being active, I give her a lot of props. I actually watched her documentary, Miss Americana, and it talked about how she was basically told, don't say anything, you're a pretty girl, you're not meant for politics, and for her to come out and take a stand completely on a different record label than her previous one, which is a shame that she can't get the rights to any of her songs, but she's working so hard to get them back. It's refreshing and nice to know that this album definitely centers around her and her fight against, you know, her past self and becoming, you know, the woman she is today. Now, there are some great songs on it. There's, you know, Me, which is, you know, the one with Brendon Urie. There's also You Need to Calm Down. My personal favorite on it right now is her song called The Man. It's like a woman empowerment song. It's, you know, just about how if she was a man, she'd get way more stuff done, which I think is unfortunately true. In this day and age, you know, where there's the wage gap and just women's equality and women's rights and everything. And I definitely think it's a big step for her to tackle all of these issues in her music. Next is Phantom's Disconnect EP. Now, I know it's not an album, but I definitely consider EPs, you know, part of, like, an album because they're an extension. Now, Phantoms, they kick ass when it comes to making music. It's crazy to see how they've grown when I saw them back in 2014 opening for Calm Truise. This music's way different than their self-titled album. It's definitely got a different vibe. The biggest jams on it are You Up? There's Designs For You, which is honestly my favorite song on the album. And then there's Say It, which is another really good song. It's definitely, like I said, it's definitely a different sound from what they were doing previously, but it's a step in the right direction for where they're headed. Number 10 is Vampire Weekend's Father of the Bride. Now, this album, I was actually really surprised. I was like, yeah, this is really good. It's a different direction for them. Compared to their previous albums, it does strip off a lot of, you know, worldliness that the last albums had, you know, using different instruments and using with more like earthly sounds and more worldly sounds, or it felt more like a soft rock or an alternative album. It felt more indie than their other stuff, and I still thought it was great. I thought it was a great album. It's not their best, but it's not their worst. Like, I personally, my favorite of theirs is still Contra. That's one of my favorites that they've done. Number 9 is Coldplay's Everyday Life. Now, this one was an interesting step for them to do. Coldplay's not usually one to do politics and get involved with, you know, stuff like that. But for them to come out and completely do a political album where they're doing taking different stances on different world issues, such as impact on orphans in different countries, police brutality, and different things with, you know, different people and events and such. And for them to tackle such a difficult topic, especially for someone as uplifting of a band as them, was definitely an interesting call. I mean, I enjoy it. I thought it was a really good album. It reminds me of their Viva La Vida album, but very stripped back. It's like Viva La Vida meets A Rush of Blood to the Head, and they squish them together with a little bit of A Head Full of Dreams sprinkled in there. Number 8 is Friendly Fires' Inflorescent. Now, Friendly Fires hadn't released an album in a good 7-ish years. The last album they released was their album Paula. You can tell that they have a lot more fun making the music on this album compared to their other albums. It's one of those you can put on from beginning to end and just let it run through the whole thing. Number 7 is Jimmy World's Surviving. Now, I was expecting for this to be a lot like their last album, Integrity Blues. Surviving's got some really fantastic songs on it. Criminal Energy is great. 555 is a jam. I would say it's probably their best album yet. It's their 10th album, which is crazy to think that they, you know, started in the mid-late 90s, and now they're on their 10th album in, you know, 2019. Number 6 is Weezer's Teal album. Now, this one was unexpected, because I knew they were coming out with a Black album, and I'm like, I don't know if that's going to be enough to keep their fans. And then in 2018, they dropped their cover of Toto's Africa, and everyone was like, that's Weezer. And then they decided, you know what, we'll just release a surprise, you know, cover album and see what people think. And oh my god, like, every single cover on it is so spot on, and it's so good, and it's crazy to see what, you know, Rivers Cuomo's, like, vocal range can do. Number 5, we have Avicii's posthumous album, which is called Tim, which his real name was Tim Bergling. So naturally, it was nice for them to release a posthumous album. He was planning to release it before he had passed away Luckily, he had left all of the files behind. Everything was basically finished. It just needed to be touched up and mixed before it was released to the public. So it was nice to see that, you know, his music before he passed away got to see the light of day. It's a shame what happened to him and that it happened so long ago. I was fortunate to see him on his true tour when it came to Boston. It's just a genuinely really good album. Like, it feels like definitely a step up from his last album, Stories. Stories, for me, it had, like, one or two good songs. Number four is Harry Styles' Fine Line. Now, this one I was completely caught off guard on. Harry Styles decided to do something a little different than other artists. And from his last album, you know, his self-titled album, he decided to try all sorts of different genres. You know, he does a little bit of funk. He does a little bit of, you know, R&B. He has a couple ballads on there. He's definitely got a lot of, like, indie rock, indie alternative, some folk in there. Like, it's a whole, like, melting pot of genres in it mixed with pop. And it's just, it's so good. Like, I want to say the album is good from beginning to end, but the big ones are Golden, Watermelon Sugar, Adore You, Lights Up. It's way better than his first album. It's honestly one of the best of the year. This is number three, which is Jonas Brothers' Happiness Begins. Now, this one was definitely an interesting album. For them to come back in 2019 was honestly one of the best moves that they ever did for their careers. In my opinion, when they released Sucker and how that blew up, the first actual piece of music that was nominated for Grammy, which was, I believe, was Song of the Year. Either Song of the Year or Record of the Year. But that's a big jump up from, you know, being Best New Artist. It's just really good. Honestly, I wouldn't say it's better than their other albums, but it's definitely equal in, like, greatness. But yeah, it actually blew my mind when it came out. Now, number two is Ariana Grande's Thank You Next. Now, that one originally was, like, my number one. That album got me through some that. It's basically her going through, you know, depression, anxiety, you know, dealing with the massacre that happened during her Manchester concert with the bombing and trying to balance, you know, her mental health and social life and fame all at once. To just listen to an album where it sounds like it's, you know, someone else that's going through it and just hearing them sing about it and recognizing that it's something that they're trying to be better at definitely resonated with me and made me realize that, you know, I'm not the only one, which is why, you know, it's one of my favorite albums of the year. Number one is Madeon's Good Faith, which, you know, I have the shirt for, because I actually got to see him the end of last year, I believe, in December. Or November, I can't remember which time, but no, it was December. But this album is my new favorite album. It's great from start to finish. It's a very short album at 35 minutes, but it's a banger all throughout. No, there's not a single feature on this album. It's every single song, just about every single song he sings on. When it's not, you know, like a chorus gospel or like, you know, backing singers and stuff like that. It's a jam. I was blown away about how good it was. That's my top 25 albums of 2019. I hope to do some more videos while under this, you know, quarantine thing. And, you know, get more news, information, and stuff out there. I'm actually looking into making more videos about, you know, life going on, more interesting things, you know, trying to make trips, talking about Annie, or in the New England that I, you know, went to back in February, and just basically talking through all this stuff and just making more videos now that I have a lot more free time. But until the next time, see you later, guys.